the Lord. Good morning, West Coast Word Church, people full of faith and victory. Amen. My family would like to say thank you so much for your prayers and support during this time. And want to remind you that as believers, this isn't a time where we question what we believe, but rather this is a time when we stand on the foundation of faith that we believe. And it is a strength that we have that only comes from God and only comes from His Word. And the Bible says this is the victory that overcomes the world, even our faith. And in fact, this isn't a time to grow weak or to grow weary. It's a time to grow stronger in our faith. And our family has taken a stand. We got together and we took a stand, and we refuse to allow the spirit of grief and sorrow into our home and into our lives. And that is the same stand I have for this church and ministry. And so, you know, the Bible says that He bore our griefs. Jesus Christ bore our griefs and He carried our sorrows. And great shall be the peace of thy children. That's the peace we have. Amen. And the Bible says that we should be far from oppression. The prophet Isaiah says that we should be far from oppression. And so by faith, we've joined together as a family, and we have said that we refuse to allow our heart to be troubled. Praise God. Amen? Amen. And so that's for your life too. Okay? Don't let your heart be troubled.
Amen.
Amen? So I want to tell you that I'm here ministering not because I'm trying to push through or to be strong or to any of that stuff that you may think. I'm up here ministering in the light of the events that happened in our family this week because I prayed about it. We originally went into mode and action to have Pastor Kurt minister this morning. We had a hotel room for him. He was planning on ministering here. But I said, you know what, Pastor Kurt, I did not pray about it. Not that he wouldn't do a wonderful, marvelous job, but I want to hear from the Holy Spirit. And I said, let me pray, give me some time, and I'll give you the answer. So I did so, and I heard from the Lord, and the Lord instructed me to minister this morning. So that's why I'm up here. Would have been a lot easier not to, if you would, but it's always best to follow what the Lord says to do. Amen. Not what you want to do, not what you like, and not even what's always comfortable for you to do, but follow what the Lord has for you to do. So that's why I'm here ministering. Praise God. So I appreciate your prayers and strength, and we had a wonderful first service. Our families cried, we've laughed, we've cried some more, and we'll cry some more, okay? But we're going to stand. We're going to stand. We're going to stand in what we believe. It's not a time, you know, I was at a football game for my son on Friday night, and this guy came up to me and he said, how are you here? How are you doing this? And I said, because what we believe is much more than religion. What we believe is a reality, and it's who we are. And, you know, to the person that's an unbeliever, that's they don't quite understand that, you know. It's not quite computable to their mind. But what we believe is that Jesus Christ is the same yesterday, today, and forever, that we serve a good and loving and gracious God. We believe that because of what the Word of God says, right? And so we stand, and I appreciate you standing with us. In fact, this church is not going to grow weak. This church is not going to have any division as a result of it. In fact, we're not going to lose one single person over this. We're going to increase, and this church is going to flourish like it's never flourished before. Amen? Amen. Amen. Because we're going to see the glory of God and the presence of God unlike we ever have. You know, when the Lord spoke to me about this year of extraordinary peace, you know, it was what the Lord spoke to us. Did I know that me and my family would need that extraordinary peace unlike ever before? No, I didn't know it, but God knew it. And God prepared our heart. Because you see, the provision of what God has is there before we ever have a need. Amen. So let's pray. Heavenly Father, we come to you in the name of Jesus Christ, and we thank you, Father, for your word. We thank you, Lord, for your anointing. Now, I open my heart to hear from you, receive from you, and I pray that every person in this room does the same. Lord, now I pray that you would speak through my vocal cords and think through my mind that this word would come forth uninterrupted, unobstructed by any satanic or demonic force in Jesus' name. Lord, I thank you you've given us ears to hear and hearts to understand that you would minister your love and your truth to each and every person here and every person watching online. Thank you, Lord, for being a good God in Jesus' name. Amen. Praise God. You have your Bible, go to John 14:1, please. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Help me, Holy Ghost. Praise God. John chapter 14, verse 1. We have it up on the screen as well. It says, "Let not your heart be troubled." Right? Let not your heart be troubled. He said, you believe in God? Believe also in me, right? In my Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you. I go to prepare a place for you. How many of you know that Jesus Christ is preparing a place for you? Yes. For every believer, he's preparing a place in heaven for you. Thank you, Lord. Praise God. He said, I will come again and I will receive you unto myself, that where I am, there you may be also. Jesus Christ is coming again. And I believe he's coming very soon. And whether I go, you know, but Thomas said unto him, Lord, we not know where you're going. And so how can we know the way? Verse 6 says, Jesus said unto him, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man cometh unto the Father but by me. Listen, good works don't get you to heaven. Religion doesn't get you to heaven. Going to church doesn't get you to heaven. Believing that Jesus Christ is the Son of God. Believe in your heart, confess with your mouth. That's how a person is saved, born again, and goes to heaven. It's through the one man, Jesus Christ. Hallelujah. He said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man cometh unto the Father but by me. Jump down to verse 26. But the Comforter, which is the Holy Ghost. Say that with me. But the Comforter, which is the Holy Ghost. Say it again. But the Comforter, which is the Holy Ghost. You must understand that the Comforter is the Holy Ghost. And he is the only one that can bring true comfort to a person's life. He is the only one. The person of the Holy Ghost is the only one that can bring a person true comfort in life. That is his job, if you will. That is his responsibility, if you will, is to bring you comfort. And he is flat out good at it. He's the best at it. And only he can bring you a comfort that no one else and nothing else can bring a person in this earth's realm. The comfort of the Holy Ghost. Did I make myself crystal clear? Only the comfort of the Holy Ghost can bring you true peace and comfort in your life. Not an island with a hammock and a stack of coconuts and a stack of bananas and no cell phone reception. That can't bring you true comfort. It is only the person of the Holy Ghost that can bring a person comfort. Not six figures, seven figures in your bank account can bring you comfort. That can't bring you the comfort that the Holy Ghost can bring you. I want you to clearly understand that it is only the comfort of the Holy Ghost. Not a big house, not this, not that, not any other person on this earth can bring you comfort like the person of the Holy Ghost. Only Him. Only Him. He says, but the Comforter, which is the Holy Ghost, whom the Father will send in my name. And He sent Him. He shall teach you all things and bring all things. How many things? All things to your remembrance. Whatsoever I have said unto you. Peace I leave with you. Peace I leave with you. He said, my peace I give unto you. This is Jesus, the Son of God, saying this to mankind. Peace I leave with you. My peace I give unto you. Not as the world giveth, give I unto you. Then He says it again for a second time in the same chapter of John. He says, let not your heart be troubled, neither let it be afraid. Say it again. Let not your heart be troubled. Now, the only way a person can experience this kind of comfort, this kind of peace is in their life, is by them exercising and releasing their faith in the words of Jesus Christ and in the help of the Holy Spirit. It's the only way, people. It's the only way. I'm not ministering this message in light of what happened to our family. If you don't know, my brother went home to be with the Lord last Sunday night in an accident. And I'm not ministering this because of that. It just so happens that in light of that, in ministering this, this is a big help to us. I want you to know I minister what I hear from the Holy Ghost up here, okay? And so if you're sitting here going, well, you're only preaching that because of that. No, it's not. I preached this last week, and I'm preaching this week, and I'm going to keep preaching this until the Lord tells me to go somewhere else. And the words of Jesus Christ are very powerful and very important for all of our lives, not just my family, but for all of our lives, because at some point in time in life, you're going to face challenges and situations and circumstances that are uncomfortable, if you will, and you need to know this message that you're hearing right here and right now, okay? So don't sit here and go, oh, that's just for them. No, it's not. It's for you, okay? Amen? And when you know the truth, and it's only by the truth that you can be set free from depression, anger, whatever it is that the enemy tries to bring your way, okay? You don't need to be oppressed. You don't need to be depressed. You don't need to be in grief and sorrow. Jesus paid that price for us. He bore our grief and sorrow on the cross so we don't have to. Well, how do I not grieve and sorrow like the world grieves and sorrows? Because you have to exercise your faith in the words of Jesus Christ, and you have to receive the comfort of the Holy Ghost. And you have to receive Him 1,000 times a day, then you receive that comfort 1,000 times a day. Well, I don't know how to do it. Yeah, when you develop your faith in that comfort and you speak out with your mouth and say, help me, Holy Ghost. I did a teaching years ago, help me, Holy Ghost. I have used that teaching thousands of times since I did that teaching. And it may be this situation or that situation or 100 situations that I've dealt with. And I've just stopped and said, help me, Holy Ghost. I need your help. I need your comfort. I need your wisdom. I need your guidance. I need the truth on this matter. And He helps me every time. And He'll help you every time. You know why I know that? Because Jesus doesn't lie. God doesn't lie. God is not a liar. Satan's a liar. Jesus Christ gave us the truth. He is not a man that He should lie. He does not lie. And so when he says that, then that's what he'll do for you. But the only way you're going to receive it in your life and experience in your life is by faith. I got to go, oh, your mind goes, well, you can't be comforted in this situation. And my spirit goes, oh, yes, I can. And I can do it because God said I can do it. So I exercise my faith in what the Word of God says. I receive that comfort right now. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. You know, the only reason the enemy has had such a grip on the world, in fact, sad to say, he's had a grip on a lot of Christians. They even go to church. It's because of what the scripture says. It says that in Corinthians, 2 Corinthians 4:4, it says, Satan, who is the god of this world, has blinded the minds of those who don't believe. Now, there are Christians that believe that Jesus Christ is the Son of God and are going to heaven, but they don't believe that they can be redeemed from trouble and sorrow and grief and worry. Well, why is that? Well, the Bible says why that is too, because they haven't been taught. It says, how will they know? Unless they've been taught. Unless there's a preacher. Unless there's a pastor. Unless there's an evangelist. Unless the fivefold ministry has given them this truth. But when you get a hold of the truth, they'll get set free in that area. And you know what? The grip that the enemy had in your life in that area, broken. Broken. And then you have to exercise your faith to stay free. You have to stay free. You know, some people are like, well, how did that person, you know, they got saved and you know, they were alcoholic and everything else. They were going to church and they weren't drinking anymore, and it seemed like everything was going good, and they weren't doing any drugs anymore. And I saw them a few years later, and all of a sudden, you know, they're back drinking and back doing drugs. Because you have to exercise your faith to stay free. You got to stay built up spiritually. You got to have spiritual strength. The Bible says resist the devil. Well, how do you resist the devil? With spiritual strength. And if you're not in church, and if you're not reading the Bible, and you're not getting in it for yourself, Don't get religious. That doesn't impress God. Say, I need your truth, Lord. I need your strength. And if you feel temptation coming at you in any area of your life, you got to use the Word of God. It's your sword. It's the weapon that you use. The weapons of our warfare are not carnal, but mighty through God to the pulling down of strongholds. Amen. We resist the enemy. The enemy hates to be resisted. When Jesus was tempted of the devil, and just because you're tempted of the devil doesn't mean there's something wrong with you. You might ask yourself, if I'm not being tempted, what's wrong with me? Because maybe you're already living in it. Some of you got that. You resist the devil. You resist darkness. You resist oppression. You resist every lie of the enemy. Every one. The enemy says that, you know, you'll never succeed. You know, you're just, you know, now look at your life. Now look at your life. Hey, your best days are yet to come. And you got to confess that out of your mouth. And your mind might say, how could that be? But you let your spirit lead you into the best days of your life. Amen? Hallelujah. Praise God. So many people think that all there is to life is what they experience here on this earth. But the reality is, this time on earth, our experiences that we have, even if you live to the ripe age of 120 years of age old, it is, the Bible says that this life on this earth is but a vapor, a mist, or a fog. It's like, you know how the morning can be kind of foggy? And then by 11, 10, 11, 12 o'clock, the temperature and the dew point begin to get that spread beyond 4 degrees. Guess what happens? It's gone. That's what this life, the Bible says that's what this life is here on this earth. This experience here on this earth is the shortest time spectrum that you'll ever experience compared to eternity. You got to understand, God is. God, who is, created the earth. And he created mankind after his image. God is eternal. When you were created in the womb, that was a supernatural conceiving. You took on a body. Your body developed in your mother's womb. You came out screaming, most of you. Probably because you knew what you were coming into. This whole book is set up to show and reveal to us that there's much more than this life. And this whole book is teaching us how to live eternally beginning now. You don't begin living eternally after you shed your physical body. The moment you became a speaking spirit, you became an eternal being. The difference between where you live eternity, where you spend eternity, is based on the decision that you make here, because you see, you have a free will to choose life or death. That life or death isn't what your heart pump does or your brain waves. That life or death is a spiritual life or death. Those who choose life live eternity in the realm of heaven. Those who don't choose life will live eternity in the bowels of hell. Choosing life is so important. When we become Christians, we are not Christians out of a religion. What has happened is man has tried to make a religion out of Christianity. The enemy has tried to fake and mask and duplicate Christianity with many other kinds of religion, trying to bring confusion in the earth of what is true. But there is only one true God, and it is Jehovah. There can only be one true God. It's not Allah, it's God Almighty. The El Elyon, the Most High God, is who the one true God is. And the Bible says that every knee will bow and every tongue will confess Jesus Christ is Lord. Don't be confused by the enemy. Don't let him come in here and try to make you think, well, you know, there's this religion and that religion, and they're all kind of the same. I'm just telling you, no offense, but there isn't. There's only one true God. And there's only one Son of God, which is Jesus Christ. And now I will say this, after Jesus Christ came, and he is our Savior, because he took the sin and the transgression of the world upon him. And as we receive him, what happens to our spirit is our spirit comes alive. That spiritual life comes into us. And now we live eternity in heaven. This life is very important in terms of the decisions that you make. But this life is still very short in terms of eternity. And if you will just shut your head up and listen to your heart. The Spirit of Almighty God is like a candle, and he will speak to your heart, and he will lead you. And that is exactly why you are here today. Or it's exactly why at some point in your life you accepted Jesus Christ. Because the Spirit of God bears witness with your spirit, and we become sons of God or children of God. It's beautiful. And if you're here today and you've never accepted Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, and you can't confidently say that if you were to die today, that you know that you know that you know that you know beyond a shadow of a doubt where you would spend eternity, you better get saved today. Stop messing around, stop goofing around, and stop being deceived by the enemy, making you think that you've got one more day. That grip's been broken. Go with me to John 14, 27. It's where we read earlier. It says, peace, I leave with you. My peace I give unto you. Not as the world giveth, give I unto you. Let not your heart be troubled, neither let it be afraid. Amen? Now go to Philippians chapter 4, verse 7. In the name of Jesus Christ, there is a boldness that's rising up in this church, in the lives of the people here today, a boldness of faith, a boldness of wisdom, and a help and a boldness of the Holy Ghost to proclaim your goodness and your plan for people's lives, and that thousands would come to Jesus Christ, and that we would experience your glory and your presence like never before. We open our hearts to you to receive your presence in our services, that we never, ever, ever, ever allow religion or allow our own way to try to take precedence over your way, Lord, that we would flow in your spirit in our services and in our lives, that we would hear you, we would obey you, we would follow you, and we would allow ourselves to be led and guided by you. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Oh, glory to God. Philippians 4, 7 says, the peace of God. The peace of who?
God.
The peace of God which passeth all understanding. Shall keep, right? Shall keep your hearts and your minds through Christ Jesus. For me to explain to an unbeliever this peace is difficult, because the Bible says it passes all understanding. And someone who is not born again, someone who is not a believer, the limitation of where they're at is in their understanding. Well, I just don't understand. I get it. I do understand. It's not a dig against you. I just understand something you don't understand. Well, how can you understand that? Because of my faith. Through faith, the Bible says, we understand how the worlds were framed. Someone who tries to explain creation without the understanding of the Spirit of God and the Word of God can't explain creation. They've been trying to. They've come out with science books. I was in school. They taught that silly, goofy stuff. And guess what? They revised them. Why would we revise our theory on evolution? Well, because we kind of found something else out there. Guess what? This book? Never been revised. You know why? It's never had to. Because it got it right the first time. Well, I just don't understand it. I get it. Because without faith in the Word of God, you can't understand it. But the moment you exercise faith in God's Word, this much faith, the Bible says faith the size of a grain of mustard seed can move a mountain. If you will just exercise one ounce, one effort, one notion, one little word of faith and belief in God's Word, you watch what the Spirit of God can do in your life. One word. One word from God can change your life forever. If you hear one word from God in your heart, just one word, and you go, I believe that's you, God, you watch what He does. He will begin to illuminate you and give you understanding. You had so many stinking questions and trying to figure out how this happened and that happened and God's will for this and God's will for that. And you've been so stinking confused about God and religion and everything else. And He will begin to just rearrange and change your thinking and bring your thinking in line with His thinking. And He will. The Bible says that you can operate in the mind of Christ. Hallelujah, glory to God. Hallelujah, glory to God. God does not desire for mankind to live confused on this earth. Not one man, not one little child, not one old woman or old man. He doesn't want anyone confused about who He is or the plan that He has for your life. And you might go, well, I just don't understand. What you begin to do is you begin to look at and rationalize and trying to figure out how I got here and why that happened. And your mind does not have the capacity to connect those dots, but your spirit does. Your spirit does, because it's your spirit. Your spirit is much bigger and greater than your mind, okay? And when you begin to receive stuff from the Spirit of God, He can begin to, see, you were designed to learn from your spirit, not your mind. You don't go, well, I guess that makes sense. I'll go ahead and believe it. That's not how it works. You read the Word of God. It's a spiritual book. The Bible is a spiritual book. All Scripture is inspired by the Holy Ghost, okay? Inspired by God Himself. When you read the Word of God in faith, you have to exercise your faith towards God. What happens is all of a sudden, see, this is the problem. I've talked to so many people and they said, I don't really understand the Bible. Well, the reason you don't understand the Bible is because you're trying to read it in your carnal mind. And you might go, well, how in the, I'm lost. I'm already lost. I'm already lost, Pastor. You just started. Well, see, the Bible says that the carnal mind is enmity against God. So the carnal mind will go, nope, that don't make sense. Nope, I can't understand that. Nope, I'm not spiritual. When you get born again, your spirit doesn't get born again. I mean, your mind doesn't get born again. Your spirit gets born again. And so when you begin to read, go to the Bible in faith, and you say, all right, Lord, it doesn't make a whole lot of sense to me, to my mind, but I'm going to go ahead and read it anyway. I'm going to read it because I do believe that this Bible is unlike any other book on the planet. This book has been written over thousands of years by many different accounts of people, yet all 100% inspired by the Holy Ghost. So how in the world did this dude way over here thousands of years ago, and this dude way over here, and this woman over here, and this person over here, how is it that all these accounts were put together and written down and brought into one book, and it's become a bestseller? And it's interesting because for some reason this book is the only book the stinking public school system wanted out of their schools. So maybe there is something, maybe there is a spiritual something going on here. Let me look into this book. And let me look into this perfect law of liberty. And now, help me. Help me. Help me to understand it. The pastor said, help me. Help me begin to understand. Help me begin to see your heart. Help me begin to see your will. You know, Jesus had to do this. Why would Jesus have to do it? Because He was a man. And the Bible says He was in the synagogue. His parents lost Him. Not too responsible. apologize, Mary and Joseph, but not too responsible. Jesus was found in the synagogue. What was he doing? He was reading the scriptures. That's what he was doing. And the Bible says he found himself in the scriptures. Let me tell you something. That wasn't just for him. You know, you can find yourself in the scriptures. You will find yourself in the scriptures. It'll be revealed to you in that way. He says, and the peace of God, which passes all understanding, shall keep your hearts and minds. Now, the peace of God can't be found anywhere except in Christ. And if I were to read, you know, this in John, what I've been reading, and if I were to read this in Philippians that I've been reading, and folks, if I were to read this every Sunday for the whole 2017, there'd be probably two opinions. The person who is spiritually mature would hear these words over and over again and these scriptures over and over again, and every time they hear them, they would open their heart and they would say, oh, praise God. I received that by faith. Let not my heart be troubled. Thank you for the peace that passes all understanding to keep my heart and mind. And you see, what would happen is every time they'd read it, their heart would grow and it would add to their spirit. It would add to them over and over again. And the other person, I said there's probably two responses. The other person would go, seriously? We're reading the same verses this Sunday that we've read for the last 28 Sundays? And their mind would try to sort of shut it off, and their mind would say, I heard that before. Let me give you an example. I could bring like an African macaw parrot up here, put him in this cage. Some of you'd be so distracted you wouldn't even look at me, you'd look at him. And I could read these verses every Sunday. And by the end of the year, that little bird could probably repeat these scripture verses. But it wouldn't do anything for that bird, because that bird can't exercise faith in the words that he's hearing and that he's memorizing. But we could have someone who comes off the street addicted to drugs, pornography, gets born again, walks down here, sits on the front row, hears the scripture verse for the very first time, and it can go off so big inside of them, and they could begin to weep and cry and say, you know what? I no longer have to let my heart be troubled because I have the peace of God in me. If you hear a scripture verse thousands of times, every time you hear it, you exercise your faith and you say, oh, there it is again. Oh, there it is again. It's ministering life to me. There it is again. I receive it by faith in Jesus' name. Oh, thank you, Lord. Praise God. Oh, let me hear it again. Let me hear it again. I open my heart to hear from you, Lord. Oh, Spirit of the Lord, minister to me. Minister life to me. Praise God. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Let me read this like this. The Lord took me here last night. Because when you read the Bible, make it personal to you. And the Lord, as I was reading this over and over and over again, the Lord said, read it this way. Listen to this. Aaron, peace I leave you. You see, Jesus was talking to us. Aaron, this is my peace that I give to you. It's my peace. Did you get it, Aaron? It's my peace I'm giving to you. And this is the peace that I had when I walked on the earth. And there was darkness, growth. It was dark. There was sickness. There was disease. There was infirmity. And there was people that had just no hope. I hadn't died. I hadn't been rose from the dead yet. My blood hadn't been shed yet for you. But I operated in that peace. And he said, Aaron, it's not the peace that the world can give you. The world doesn't have this kind of peace. Only I can give you this kind of peace. Only me. Aaron, don't let your heart be troubled. You hear me, son? Don't let your heart be troubled. And Aaron, don't let it be afraid. It did something on the inside of me. You put your name in there. You put your name in there. Amen? Amen. Courtney, don't let your heart be troubled. Oscar, don't let your heart be troubled. Jimmy, don't let your heart be troubled. Tammy, don't let your heart be troubled. Amen? Amen. Sandra, don't let your heart be troubled. Tim, don't let your heart be troubled. Amen? Amen. My peace I give to you. Now, one of the biggest mistakes in Christianity is that people have made everything God's responsibility. And this has come in, by and large, through religion. And if people did do something, if they felt like they had a religious obligation, it was to be good or to do something for the church. But God has a part and we have a part. Stick with me on this. If you've been here for any time at all, you know that we have pretty much debunked the all popular saying that God is in control. I don't have time to go into it too deep, but if you've ever been here, you've heard that teaching. Very popular. Very easy to say. It isn't so easy to believe. God has a part, and we have a part. Go with me to Isaiah 26. Say this with me. I have a part, and God has a part. Isaiah chapter 26, verse 3, and I'll preparing to close here. But so stay with me and stay focused. And don't let your mind wander, because this is very important. It says, thou will keep him in perfect peace, whose mind is stayed on thee, because he trusteth in thee. Trust ye in the Lord forever, for in the Lord Jehovah is everlasting strength. We all need strength. We all need physical strength, right? Have you ever had an injury and the strength in that muscle or that ligament, whatever it was, or that, you know, leg or ankle, the strength wasn't quite there? I mean, it is challenging. I mean, it's hard just to get up and go to the bathroom sometimes, you know, or whatever the case may be. But not only do we need spiritual strength, and the Lord needs that, knows that, but we need spiritual strength. A lot of people don't have any clue about spiritual strength. Some people may be here hearing this for the very first time or watching online, spiritual strength. Jesus Christ said when he was tempted of the devil that man does not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceeds out of the mouth of God. We know that, I think it was the Apostle Paul said, that faith words nourish. Now, in Isaiah, he says, that will keep him in perfect peace whose mind is stayed on thee. Now, God's peace is something that most people, quite frankly, are not too familiar with. And God's peace will provide a stability when times are difficult. And we'll all face difficult times in this earth. Now, God's part, he says, thou will keep him in perfect peace, whose mind is stayed on thee, right? His part is he'll keep you in perfect peace. This perfect peace is a peace which we read in Philippians that passes all understanding, right? This peace could be described as the Hebrew word shalom. Nothing missing, nothing broken, the peace of God in your life. He said, I will keep you in perfect peace. That's his part. Okay? God will always do his part. You don't have to check on God and say, God, are you going to do your part? I'm doing my part. He'll always do his part. Here is our part. He says, whose mind is stayed on thee. Say that with me. Whose mind is stayed on thee. God does not control our thoughts. And he does not control what you think about. Because God is a loving, gracious God who does not control his children. God loves us so much, he gives us a free will to choose life or death, blessings or cursings. Oh, that you would choose life. That's why we talk about how important it is the words that we say out of our mouth. Because with our words, often we choose a path of life or death for our lives. And he says, I will keep you in perfect peace if you choose to keep your mind stayed on me. You keep your mind on me, don't let your mind wander and go down that dark and dirty road of perversion, of oppression, of whatever else. Keep your mind stayed on me. Just keep it on me. Keep it on the word of God. Let me keep you in perfect peace. But your responsibility is you got to keep your thoughts in line with the word of God. I'll do my part. You do your part. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Now, a lot of people just don't, you know, I just said this before. I'll say it again. A lot of people are just lazy. Just lazy. They're just lazy. There are a lot of people that go to church that are just flat out spiritually lazy. Now, you might be saying, well, I'm not lazy. I get up. I go to church. I comb my hair. I go to work. I provide for my family. I do this. You're spiritual lazy. What do you mean spiritually lazy? Are you reading your Bible? Are you praying? Are you growing in your faith? Are you seeing a difference in your life for good? Are you seeing your life change? Are the decisions that you make filtered through what you've learned from the Word of God? Oh, that's good. Hallelujah. Because if you're not filtering your decisions through the God, through the Word of God and through the and running them past the Holy Ghost, you're being spiritually lazy. Lord, this is what I should do today. Is this what I should be doing? Is this the career I should be choosing for my life? What is the path and plan that you have for my life? Because your path and your plan is good and not of evil. Amen. And to give me an expected end. So what is it that you have for my life? And you might be saying, well, I'm already this age. I mean, I'm already 40 years old. I can't change careers now. Yeah, you can. If the Holy Spirit tells you to do something different, then you do something different. There is never an excuse for disobedience. If my son comes to me and I tell him to do something, and 2 days go by, and I said, did you do it? Well, no, but, I mean, that was 2 days ago. Statute of limitations ran out on that, right? So I'm working on something. My son always gets brought up in conversations here. Your responsibility is the garbage, right? take the garbage out, put it in the can, put the lid on. You've heard me say this already. You know that my son's responsibility is the garbage. Put the garbage cans on the day that the garbage goes on the cart, drive them out because it's like a quarter mile away where we have to take our garbage cans. Drop those cans off there and come back. I say, okay, I've told you, I've taught you, I've trained you in this, right? You know what days the garbage are? You know. You can remember these video games and how to get to, you know, Zuzu World through the portal of whatever. But you can't remember which days the garbage is on? I said, the only reason you can't remember is because you're choosing not to remember. And I said, now I'm telling you, I'm done telling you what days the garbage are, and I'm not going to tell you to take the garbage out. If you don't take the garbage out on those days and it's still here, there will be consequences to not taking the garbage out. And if I have to take the garbage out, I'm not going to say anything. I'm just going to take the garbage out, and then there'll be consequences associated with not taking the garbage out. Now, just because he didn't take the garbage out, and he didn't last week, does that mean I say, eh, he doesn't ever have to take the garbage out? No. The offer still stands. Take the garbage out. And I'm telling you that because you need to hear the voice of God. And I don't care how old you are. I don't care what limitations might be in your mind to be obedient to the voice of God. Disobedience is never the right option. In fact, it's never an option in terms of God. Obedience is always the best thing. And every time we obey God, every time, listen, every time, 100% of the time, every time we obey God, it's always to enrich our life and to make our life better and to make the lives better of those around us. Don't let your heart be troubled. Neither let it be afraid. He's given you his peace. And we will see and experience this year an extraordinary peace unlike we ever have. And the faithful will flourish in 2017. All the faithful, stand to your feet, please. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Heavenly Father, we come to you in the name of Jesus, and as we close out this service, Lord, I pray that the Spirit of God ministered through me to these people here and the people that are listening to this message. Thank you for giving me the strength to minister this word. When my mind told me all night long, you can't do it, when sleep evaded me last night, I stood up here in obedience to your word and I delivered this word. And you gave me the strength to carry it out. I believe it was for such a time as this. I believe that I'm standing up here not by accident or a coincidence. I'm standing up here in obedience to what you've spoken to my heart to do and to continue to do. Thank you, Lord, for life. Thank you for my family. Thank you for this church. Thank you for Veronica. Thank you for Chad. Thank you for my parents. Thank you for my brothers and my sister and my nieces and my nephews and my entire family. Thank you that I have a godly family and you are drawing us even yet closer to you and to your ways and to your will. And I thank you, Lord, that this family is having a great impact in this world for the kingdom of God. Thank you, Lord, for Chad's friend Tim and his girlfriend that are here today, for their act of faith and obedience to your word. Lord, I pray that you even minister to their life and every other person's life here, Lord. But Lord, you would just have me to mention them, to be a blessing to them. And Lord, if there's anyone here that has heard this message and hasn't made that decision to live for Jesus Christ, to be a Christian, Lord, I pray that today that is the day of their salvation in Jesus' name. And so as I close this service out, if anyone is in this room that has not made Jesus Christ the Lord of their life, prayer couples, if you would come forward at this time and stand up here right now, I would like you to get out of your seat if you're here. If you've never made Jesus Christ the Lord of your life, walk down this aisle as an act of your faith before these people, before God, before man. The Bible says that if you will acknowledge me in front of man, I will acknowledge you in front of the Father. It is an act of faith and courage for you to take. So if you're here and you've never accepted Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, just slip out of your seat right now. If that's you, the Holy Spirit is tugging you and leading you right now. It's what you're feeling in here. Just for the first time, maybe, be obedient to Him, okay? Do it. Just do it. Act of your faith and boldness. Go ahead. Come out. Or if you need prayer in any other area of your life, maybe you're struggling and dealing with something in your life and you need people that know how to believe God and have faith and that love you, please, that's what this altar is for up here, is to come up here and join with your brothers and sisters in Christ to be prayed for. Thank you, Lord. In Jesus' name, amen. Now, even as I close, if you'd like prayer, slip out of your seat and come up here. There's something that I close every service with, and it's this. You're blessed. You're above and not beneath. You're blessed going in. You're blessed going out. You're the head. You're not the tail. And everything you set your hand to prospers. You're the lender, not the borrower. You're good looking. You're dismissed. We'll see you next week.
No sweet name in the name of Jesus, no sweet name have I ever known. No sweet name in the name of Jesus, sweet name in the name of Jesus, no sweet name have I ever known.